I think how you reopen, if you want to use that word, the economy in those communities is going to depend a lot on the ability to contain what we know will happen. I'll guarantee you, once you start pulling back, there will be infections. It's how you deal with the infection that's going to count.
I'm Julie Pace.
And I'm Ralph Russo. From the Associated Press, this is Ground Game Inside the Outbreak.
Every day, Ralph will be bringing you coronavirus coverage straight from the breakout zones.
The coronavirus pandemic ranks among the most dynamic and widespread stories ever covered here at the AP, and we've got you covered from every part of the globe.
Today, we're in Washington, D.C.
So I wanted to catch up with Julie today. It's become a weekly feature on this podcast. A, again, thank you for letting me squat in your podcast. And B, you had a great interview yesterday with Dr. Anthony Fauci, who has become in some ways the face of the pandemic for U.S. officials. The headline quote from that interview was, "We're not there yet." And he was referring to lifting social distancing restrictions that have helped slow the spread of the virus, but have taken a toll on the economy. What more did he say about a May 1 target date for trying to get more businesses back and running?
Sure. Well, first, we're always happy to have you squatting in the podcast. Ralph, you can take over anytime. So Fauci was pretty interesting on this May 1st target that we've been starting to hear from President Trump, from some other officials in the White House, those who are more economic minded than public health minded. And what Fauci was saying was basically, if you're going to start talking about reopening the economy, regardless of what day you're talking about doing it on, you need to have some things in place. You need to have a really robust testing infrastructure. You need to have a way to do contact tracing. And his point is basically, if you start reopening and we don't have a vaccine and we're not close to a vaccine, you're going to have outbreaks. So if a city reopens because infections are down, it's very likely that you'll have another outbreak that happens there. And he wants to make sure that when that happens, you've got a way to quickly test and control that outbreak. And he says, look, we're just not there yet. The other thing that he said that I think is really interesting and worth remembering as we start talking about this idea of reopening the economy is that, you know, it's not like a light switch. It's not like you declare that a state or a city, you know, is open for business and everybody rushes back in. He describes this as a rolling opening, both in terms of geographically where we might see openings happen, but also within those locations. So you might see, you know, certain businesses that start to open first. You might see businesses decide that only half of their employees come back, you know, for a certain amount of time while we really test, you know, what this looks like and how fierce the virus may come back as we do start, you know, putting people in closer proximity to each other.
What did Fauci say about President Trump's daily press briefings? He's usually there, though not always, and he usually has a large role. I'm curious to know what his view of those briefings are.
Yeah, you know, this was interesting and something I've actually been wanting to ask him because I've had a lot of people ask me, you know, is this the best use of Dr. Fauci's time? Also, I've had people ask me that question about Deborah Birx, who's another public health official, a doctor who's up there quite a bit. You know, is this the best thing that they should be doing in the middle of a pandemic, spending two and a half hours, you know, standing in the White House briefing room or, you know, in the Rose Garden? And Fauci was pretty frank about it and said, hey, no, it's not the best use of my time. You know, he prefaced this by saying that he thinks it's important for him as a top public health official to be answering the public's questions, that it's important for Americans to be getting information about this. He said the issue is the length of time, you know, that he's often finding himself standing there for, you know, an hour or even more before he really gets to his part of the briefing. And he talked about all of the other things, you know, that he needs to be doing, that, you know, he is running a team at the NIH that needs his sign off on a lot of things. He needs to be able to check in on the status of a vaccine, on the antibody testings. So the briefings, while they're kind of the centerpiece of the administration's PR efforts, they're just one, you know, pretty small piece of what his actual job is day to day during this pandemic.
Yeah. And I want you to get into a little more detail there about what his job is. And you talked about testing and things along those lines and how that part of his job seems to be progressing.
Yeah. So Fauci is the top infectious disease doctor for the US government, essentially. He runs an institute at the NIH. It's a job he has had through multiple presidents. He was at the forefront of the AIDS epidemic. So he is somebody who has been a public figure in certain circles for quite some time. And he is quite adept at speaking publicly about these complex issues. And that's why he is a bit more forward facing than other medical researchers, other people, who are in similar types of jobs. And it's why you do see him on television. It's why you do see him at the White House briefings. But he also is deeply involved in the substance of the medical response, the actual public health response. And two things in particular that he is really focused on right now is the status of a vaccine, which is going to be key for when we may be able to get, back to some semblance of normal. But then the other thing is this antibody test that we are talking about quite a bit right now, which would allow states and cities to be able to, do testing and be able to determine if people had coronavirus already. Because again, a lot of people may have the virus and not actually have ever been tested or may not even have had symptoms. And if that means then they would be immune going forward. So those people might be able to go out, kind of back into the world sooner than others.
So one last thing about the briefings, and they are, have frequently been somewhat contentious between reporters and the president. But lately, they've also taken a little bit of a turn towards sort of touting the accomplishments of the administration. That seems like a strategy here that the administration feels like maybe it's been given the short shrift as far as the good things that it has done.
Yeah, I mean, look, these are briefings that ostensibly are meant to inform the public, to give updates on hotspots, to give updates on the government response, and for reporters to ask questions. The reality is that Trump is trying to use these to bolster his own standing. We saw this really extraordinary briefing earlier this week where he opened by attacking the media and then playing a propaganda video. I mean, there's really no other way to put it. It was essentially a campaign ad. I've covered the White House for a long time. I've sat through a lot of briefings. I've never seen anything like that. A president so overtly using that briefing room to tout their own accomplishments and to again, really just run a campaign ad. And, this creates some tension, certainly between reporters and the administration, but also within the administration. Again, this is intended to be a way for the government to communicate to people. You have Americans who are dying, you have Americans who are falling ill, and the show, really, which is what it is, at the briefing room sometimes just has such a disconnect from that reality. And I think what we saw earlier this week was one of really, I think, the most egregious examples of that.
All right. So you mentioned campaign ad. Let's talk about the campaign. Joe Biden has not officially locked up the Democratic nomination, but with Bernie Sanders out of the race, he is the presumptive nominee. Sanders has thrown his support behind Biden. President Obama quickly endorsed his former VP. But because of the pandemic, it feels like we have a presidential candidate who has become somewhat invisible. But I would ask, is that helpful for Joe Biden to have sort of slipped into the background here?
Yeah, there are a couple of theories of the case on this. I mean, certainly, I don't think this is what Joe Biden would prefer to be happening, politically speaking. But it is hard for him, even as the presumptive Democratic nominee right now, to really break through. There's so much else happening. People's attention really isn't, on the campaign. We're only in April, the election's not till November. So there's a feeling, I think, that, people will focus in on it, in the next couple of months, but really they're just so glued to coverage of the pandemic right now. So that is hard for Biden because it means that, if there are Democrats out there who are a little shaky on him, he's having trouble, getting in front of them to start making his case. Certainly it can affect things like fundraising, which, even though he's not traveling right now, a campaign infrastructure is really expensive. But the other side of this, and I've heard this from some Biden advisors, is they do feel like, this is an election that is going to be a referendum on Donald Trump more than it is going to be an election on Joe Biden. And it will in particular probably be a referendum on Trump's handling of this crisis, both the health crisis and also the economic crisis. And, having Trump under a microscope right now, having Americans really, take some time to watch him, to listen to him, and to gauge, how they feel about his reaction might not be a bad thing. if you're Joe Biden, of course, you're hoping that Americans are looking at these daily White House briefings and saying, you know, I don't want any more of that. I don't want four more years of that. I think we also have to, though, deal in reality that there are plenty of Americans, probably about half right now, who look at those daily briefings and think, yeah, give me more of this. This is exactly the kind of leadership that I want to see in a crisis. So it definitely cuts both ways to have Trump really at the center of attention and dominating the conversation.
Julie Pace is AP's Washington Bureau Chief. Thanks for joining me today on your podcast, Julie. And hopefully we'll talk again real soon.
Happy to do it, Ralph. We'll talk soon for sure.
Today at APnews.com, our One Good Thing series is a story about a photo. A coworker snapped that photo of a married nurse couple in an eye-to-eye embrace despite layers of protective gear. The image, then shared on social media, is inspiring people around the globe. Go to APnews.com for the photo and the story behind it and all the news you need about the coronavirus pandemic.
That's it for this episode of Ground Game. We'll be here every step of the way during this extraordinary moment in American politics and American life, giving you all the news you need to know. Be sure to tell a friend about us, and please subscribe on Apple Podcasts and leave us a review. Some of the details of our discussion may have changed by the time you hear this. For up-to-date developments on all of your news, head over to apnews.com. From the Westwood One Podcast Network.